happy holidays and Merry Christmas from me, Robin Beam, Product Development Director here at Spellbinders. And I'm really excited to show you some Christmas stitching dies that we're going to be releasing this year. And I'm also going to provide you with some really fun and easy tips to help you have a very Stitchmas Christmas. So let's go. What we have is, as part of our Stitchmas Christmas line, is we have two backgrounds, one of which is the Christmas Argyle. You can see that there's some stitching here with little blocks, and you can even see you can do it landscape or profile, and how nice this looks. And this is with our stylish Merry Christmas on top of it, but it makes a really nice card, and you'll see it works really well with variegated floss. The other background is our stitched petal diamond, and this is using the Diamant thread, and you can see how you can do a lot of different types of stitching through this to make a wonderful background. So this one's a lot of fun. And again, the backgrounds can be used for cards all year round. We also have the Stitched Joy, and you can see there's some real basic stitching here for what you could say are the evergreens, and then the little berries and the leaves. And there's just some really beautiful effects that you can get. And here we've used the pop-up die cutting foam for the joy. But see all the different textures of like the 3D embossing folder, the glitter foam, as well as the stitching and the color essential gems. It just creates a wonderful effect for a card. And the last one, which is not the least and one of my most favorites, is the new stitched ornament, which I have been bugging Josie to do an ornament since we started doing stitching. And you can see it's like reminiscent of a vintage ornament, and just the adding of the little dies on top to create that additional effect, and then adding some of the crystals. This is not only wonderful for a card, but can also be used for a banner, which I'm all about banners, or you can make them into real ornaments that you can use on the tree. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use some of these dies to show you some really nice stitching tips that you can use for all your stitching dies. So we'll get started with that. All right, one of the first tips that I'm going to talk to you about is when you're working with the variegated floss. I've put this onto a bobbin. And sometimes when you're working with smaller areas, you might continue to have the same color, but you want it to change color. So don't be afraid to cut smaller sections of floss and change it up so that you can get a change up of colors of the floss so that you have variation in your design when you're working with it. As you can see on this one, I have lighter colors up here and I have some darker colors down here. So I have some real nice variation in the colors. And sometimes that's just by cutting and starting with a different color. So don't be afraid to do that. That's not against the rules. The other thing you'll find is most of the time I will use 2 out of 6 of, the floss has 6 strands to it. Many times I'll just use 2 strands, but in some cases you can use 3. And what you need to understand is when you're working with these is depending on how many holes that you have, what's going to happen, and this doesn't have the gems on it, so you can see it a little better, is that see how everything lays around there nicely? It doesn't bunch up on one another. Then you know that the 3 strands will work nicely. If you have a case where things start to, the strands start to bunch up too much over one another, you probably need to back it off and go to using 2 strands. Otherwise, it's just going to look too bulky and it's not going to look clean. But as you see here, everything lined up nicely around each other. So that's where you get a nice look and effect with your stitched dies. So when you're starting working with your dies and working with your floss, so on this one, and for those who have already done embroidery or crewel, you probably know this, but when you are working with a thread and you want to pull them off, don't just take 3 and just start with it. What you want to do is you do want to separate them out and then put them back together again. And to do that, but you got to be careful so that you don't create a knot. But doing that and putting them back together again, it kind of fluffs up the threads so that you get a nice effect when it just lays down nicer on your thread. One of the other things that I like to do is you don't want to really necessarily knot the back of your dies. I use tape. Some people use yellow tape. I think Josie uses yellow tape a lot. Some people use glue. But what you want to do is I just have just some regular Scotch tape. And what I do is I just rip off and do like a thin piece. And then I just cut off small pieces with that. So I have that on my scissors. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to start here. And I'm going to run this through, and you'll see I'll come to the back. And I'm going to lay the thread down. You want to have a little bit of an extra tail so you can trim it. So then I just take my tweezers, and then I'm just going to take the tape, and I'm going to lay it down like that. All right? Now, later on, we're going to glue something to the back of this. But this is going to keep it so that you can keep it taut. So see how you have that there? So another important thing that you're going to do is when you start your thread, you're not going to start down. Because see, the thing is that, see, the tape is on this side. So you're not going to start down because what's going to happen is this thread is crossing over the center of the line. So it's not going to look right when you start to stitch. What you're going to do is you're going to go back in the same direction. So this goes up. So we're going to go up on the hole. And see what it does is it keeps, you can tell when I pull it tight, see how that hole stays clear? You want to do that because when you're going to line these up, a lot of times the holes can be seen from the back. So what you're going to do is you're then going to put the next thread through. And this is another little tip that I found. You kind of want to, the best way I can describe it is you want to read your thread. So see the next line where it's coming? You've got to decide whether you want to go this way or this way. All right? You want to try not to have the thread cross over the other lines. It just makes it look bulky and not as neat. So this one seems to be telling me I want to go to the right. And so I'm going to thread it through. And see how it lays next to it, how nicely it lays next to it. So it's just working the way you want it to work. And so I'm just going to bring that through. And as you go, see how it lays next to each other nicely. It doesn't really cross over. Then it's going to create a nice effect. See, like on this top one, how it went all the way around and it didn't cross over. And so you still have a nice clean hole through the middle if you don't want to add a gem through and if you want the color of the base underneath to be able to go through. Another tip is, and I know sometimes you want to have the longest thread possible. You wish you had the longest thread possible so that you could get this done without having to change thread. But the longer the thread is the higher probability that as you pull it through, it's going to knot on itself. And so you want to avoid that as much as possible. Another thing you'll see is as I'm holding this, I'm kind of underneath, I'm holding it a little taut. You want to keep holding it, and you get into a rhythm. You want to be able to keep it so that the threads stay nice and, I don't want to say tight, but taut in their place. And so because then it just lays nice on the die on the paper and it's just going to give you a nicer effect. So I'm going to pretend that I have finished this oval and I'm going to go to another area. And so what you want to do is don't just go to the other area. I want to keep these threads I want them to stay tighter. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn over and I'm going to run under a couple of the threads on the back. And then I'm going to go back again, not in the same direction. I'm going to overlap a little bit. And I'm going to go back down over here. And what that does, it's anchored the thread in so that your nice tight threads that you have here will stay tight so that when you work, go into the next section, it's going to stay nicely. Because otherwise, what might happen is it can start to loosen up. But by anchoring that section, I can then go to another area. So see, there's these little areas down here. I'm going to just go here. And I'm just going to start doing that. Now, I'm going to show you the back. So see how I can go to that next section? One of the other things you want to also avoid is having the thread cross over into the other holes. Because when you back this up, as I'm going to show you here, see how this is backed up? Right way. See how you can see all the holes here? There's not covered with anything. So you don't want your thread to cross over those holes because then it will fill in those areas and you won't get that nice, clean, white background or whatever background you're going to use for these ornaments. So what I will do sometimes, as you can see the back here, I will tape things down so that if I'm going from one section to another, I am going between, see here, I'm going between the two holes. Here I went between the two holes. So it gives you a clean path so that you're not blocking the holes. So that is a nice way to be able to work with that. One of the other things that I like to do, especially if I want to create a banner or something, is I want to back this. And so the way I do it is I love to use the Barely Arts glue, which I have here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to just create a line around, but I'm also going to go over some of the thread as well. And the thing is that is going to help to keep everything in place. I try to avoid the holes, but I have a trick for that. I'm just going to do this quickly. And I'm going to show you how to avoid having any blobs of glue going to the other, going through, or to minimize that. And I do this trick for a lot of my detailed die cuts. So this is something that you can use all the time. And you can use this with some scrap paper, or you can use this with this tip with like a little notepad, which I have here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to initially just pat this down on the scrap paper. And what that's going to do, it's going to help to smush out the glue and take any excess off. And then I'm going to just line this up. And I do, make sure you have clean hands. And you minimize the amount of glue that's going to push through. And it's going to dry clear. But you just line it up. And see how nicely that will set, like these have. See, and now it's hard. It's a nice look. And one of the things that you can do is I'm done with this, I'll add gems like I have here. So here I did a little bit bigger ones. Here I kept them a little smaller. But one of the other neat things that you can do is you can back these like this and you can make an ornament that would, you can hang and it can turn and you can see how that is. But the other thing you can do is this is where you can stamp a message, you can put a photo. There's a lot of different fun things that you can do with that. But see, this creates a nice surface. And this is where you can also create more dimension by whether it's a white background or if you wanted to do a brushed metal background or even a mirror metal background. And that will create some more shine and sparkle with that. And so, and here's the dies, as you can see, You have your rim die that you can do your background. You then have your insert that you would tape in. And then this decorative piece, you would cut this twice for the bottom and the top of the ornament. And then you have your ornament hanger. And that tip that I showed you about patting the excess glue onto the scrap paper before you attached it, this die is a perfect die to do that with, so that you don't get any excess glue that will ooze out underneath the paper. So on those ornaments, that's a great thing. Another thing that I want to show is this is the Argyle background. And as you see, I'm using the Diamant thread, which is the metallic thread. And what's nice about this thread is it has more pliability to it. If you look at some of the metallic DMC flosses that are in, like in the regular floss, those are very stiff and those are hard to work with. This takes a little bit of getting used to, but again, don't have too long of a thread. And I just do this one single. You probably could do double, but I think this creates a nice delicate effect. And again, I'm going to show you the back. You'll see where I had tape. And again, like I had shown you on the ornament, when I went from one section to the next, I went between the two holes so that it doesn't, and here again, I did it here, so that it doesn't cross over into these holes. Because when you back this onto white cardstock or whatever color cardstock you're using, you're going to be able to see that. So you don't want to see those threads underneath. All right. See how that is? And what's nice about this is that you can do different colors. You can do the gradation like I had shown with this card to get a different effect. And there's just a lot of fun. But with something like this, again, I went from here. I put my piece of tape between the two holes. And then as I had shown before, you're going to start it so that it's going back in the same direction. So see, this is going toward the corner. So if I start in that same direction with the thread, it's not going to cross over that center line. And as I also indicated before, reading your thread, and especially on this, see how I'm holding it down so it's a little more tight? Because this is a looser thread. It doesn't want to grab because of the metallic nature to it. But you can, once you get working with it, it's easy to work with. So see, this one, it wants to go to the right. So I'm just going to keep running that through. And when I get to the end, I'm going to anchor it and then go to another section by running my thread through between the holes so that you're not hiding it. And next thing you know, you're going to have this done. This is the perfect type of a thing where you cut up a bunch of these, and thing is that you'll be able to start now and start creating ornaments for the season that you can give on a card as a gift, or you can create home decor for your house. And just see how beautiful that is. It's subtle on this paper, but it is just beautiful, and it could be for any type of card all year round. So the most important thing is to have fun with Stitchmas Christmas dies and any stitching die. And hopefully some of the tips that I gave you will help you get even faster as you start stitching and threading these, having some fun with color and to create some unique effects and designs. So get stitching and have a wonderful holiday.